Hi, everyone. This is Aaron, and you are listening to the Sound Words Podcast. Today's guest is Pastor Harold Kim. He is the senior and founding pastor of Christ Central of Southern California and serves on the board for Christ Central Network. He serves as the president of the SOLA Network. In this episode, we talk about Christ Central Church, Korean American churches, his role as the president of the SOLA Network, and the flagship traits of the SOLA Network's mission and ministry. Thanks for listening. I was actually talking to Pastor Steve, and he said, we're going to revamp our SOLA newsletter, and we're just going to do like a redesign and try to kind of offer more behind the scenes or like exclusive content. And Pastor Steve said, Pastor Harold would be a great interview. And so I said, okay, can you get us in touch? So thanks for being willing to do this.
Thank you for doing this, and very kind of Steve. No, thank you for doing this, Aaron. Look forward to being able to meet you and talk to you at some point.
One day we're going to have to meet in person. Yeah. But I guess, why don't you tell me a little bit about yourself, Pastor Harold? Because we never met before. I'm reading your SOLA Network staff bio right now, and I just went on your Instagram page to see what kind of pictures you got on there. Says here you're the senior and founding pastor of Christ Central of Southern California. Why don't you tell me more about that?
Been at the church for 12 years. We became Christ Central, meaning as a Presbyterian church. Well, let me back up. 12 years ago, I came to the English ministry. In English ministry, I have a predominantly Korean church, which is called Cerritos Presbyterian Church. So I got called to become the English ministry pastor there. I was on the East Coast before that. And then about 5 years in, we transitioned and we became a church of our own. What that means is you become a church of your own by basically getting your own leaders or elders. So we ordained our own elders, started with 3 to 4. And our whole vision behind that was that we wanted to fully mature by making our own mistakes. And we wanted to be much more accommodating and effective in our mission, which is to obviously reach English-speaking neighbors and friends. So we were the first church of its kind in our denomination, which is the largest Korean denomination in America, as I understand. We're the first English ministry or department that actually became its own church. And in large part, that's a real, real story of just honor and praise for the Korean-speaking senior pastor that I worked with. He gave the green light for all that. So 12 years ago as it came, 5 years after that, which is about 7-8 years ago, we became CCSC, changed our name, have our own budget, have our own separate tax ID number. then we have a multi-site. We planted a church off the mother church campus. So we have 2 services, one which is over at Fullerton at Hope International University. And then we have a second service, which is sharing the campus with Cerritos Presbyterian Church.
Yeah, yeah. You're kind of actually, I mean, we're not too far away from you guys. I'm actually in Alhambra right now, but I go to FCBC Walnut. So we're not that far from you.
Right? No.
Are you at the Cerritos campus or the Fullerton campus?
So whoever speaks that day, you speak at both. So the worship service over at Hope, which is right next to Cal State Fullerton, is at 10 a.m. And the service back here at Cerritos Presbyterian Church, which is in the city of Artesia, though. That's confusing.
Okay.
But it's called Cerritos Presbyterian Church.
Sure.
So CCSC has a second service there at 11:30. Mm-hmm. 12 years, immensely grateful, thankful. I think you caught me at a good season. I think one of the most all ministry is depending on seasons. You happen to catch me at a good one. One of the healthier, happier, growing times, positive times right now. Mm-hmm. Thanks be to God because of our staff. Our staff is just, they're excellent. And we just added 5 elders, so there's 8 elders.
Oh, wow. Okay, so I go to a Baptist church, but I do like the Presbyterian church model of doing things with the elders. Well, I know that there are some Baptist churches that have elders. We don't have yet, but hopefully we can go towards that. But that's me speaking on behalf of me, not on behalf of FCBC.
Well, I have so many. You're Chinese?
Yeah, right? Yeah. I'm Chinese, FCBC is First Chinese Baptist Church. But we have wide range of Asian Americans, but yeah, mostly Chinese.
Right. My first, I would say, most rose colored, kind of like my honeymoon, first full time, first ministry experience was with Stanford students. And there's a Bible study that started there and it grew. And the majority was all Chinese and Taiwanese and more. And I just say this because you're, I'm just saying all their backgrounds are Baptist or non-denominational. That's what I remember. So
yeah.
But coming back to Presbyterianism, I don't know where this conversation is headed, but you know, the Presbyterianism part is it's such a secondary issue. It's definitely not the most important issue.
No, I appreciate
but I do think it's a neglected issue these days. I think people, we kind of all grow up, we love Jesus, want to read the Bible, share about Jesus, and that's wonderful. But it's not like you kind of grow up and then you figure out, oh, but church takes governance. Like church, it's an organization, it's an institution.
Right.
We have to figure out how to lead it.
Like yeah.
We have to figure out what are the laws.
Yeah, exactly.
And so the one thing, my little plug about Presbyterianism that I like, although this is not the gospel itself, it's not the most important thing, not at all.
Sure.
But I think it's a happy medium. And the way that I understand and appreciate Presbyterianism is that it's more like the American government, which is representative democracy. So you have the Episcopalian, Catholic, really kind of top down. So you just have kind of one pope, one bishop, or one guy in charge. That's one extreme. And the other extreme, which I think America is very popular with, and some Baptists and independent congregations tend to be this way, is where you just take a majority vote. Like it's all democratic. So I think there's cautions and pros and cons to every system. I think Presbyterianism is kind of in the middle, representative democracy, representative leaders. And, you know, our weaknesses and cons is that we have too many meetings, processes take too long.
Yeah.
Because we're all about checks and balances, but that's one of its strengths too.
Yeah. Well,
little spiel on that.
No, that I appreciate your balanced view. And I mean, those problems are, I'm sure, existing in all different denominations too.
Absolutely. Because we're sinful, we're corrupted, no matter what system we're in.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. Really quick, before we move on, is it common for Korean churches, I guess, to split with the English ministry versus the Korean speaking ministry? Is that like a common practice, or is that something that's happening like kind of today?
It's a great, great question. I think it's absolutely uncommon, rare. It's like a unicorn if you split in a healthy way. So by split in a healthy way means like church planting, you're giving birth with mutual blessings. And that is what has occurred with CCSC and Sweden's Presbyterian Church. Most other Korean churches, and I understand it's Asian churches, you have two other options. Is one is just you remain a department, you remain under the house as one room, right? And you basically have to assimilate. Or the other option is they physically just take off from the campus and want nothing to do with the first generation Chinese or Vietnamese or Korean anymore. You got so tired of it, right? Like they were holding us back. You know, we can't do our missions without them.
Right.
And there's problems on both sides of that, you know.
Of course.
Scenario. But so those are your two most trendy models, which was we either completely declare independence and we physically depart, usually not in a healthy way. Because once you take off, that mother church has to start its own English ministry again, just with someone else. Or the other is that you stay kind of like a child, the full-grown child inside the same house, and you rent a room, but you never get to own it, which I think doesn't allow you to really mature.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Become a full leader.
That analogy of the parent and child is like sounds very perfect.
Well, it's part of our Confucian culture, right? It's so steeped in our culture. And there's biblical elements that are good about that and wrong about that as well. But I love it that we're so communal. So, yeah, let alone not just Korean American churches, I don't think many Asian American churches, we are side by side in a healthy dynamic, two independent churches sharing the same campus, but CCSC is absolutely free and unhindered in carrying out her mission. So, for instance, we launched another worship at another site. That's us.
Well, thanks for taking the time to answer that one. You know, in all honesty, like I've been at FCBC my entire life. And so even like kind of knowing about other churches and the way other churches do things, I'm not that knowledgeable about it. And I really didn't know too much about Korean churches or, you know, Korean culture or the way stuff happens there before I started looking into SOLA. Because with SOLA, you have a wide range. And so I did just kind of look around at the different churches and just see like, oh, yeah, there are different churches that do things differently. But like you mentioned earlier, yeah, we all do preach the gospel, you know, and that is of utmost importance over our cultural preferences. So as president of the SOLA Network, what do you do exactly? What is that role?
Well, first off, I get called by technologically savvy young folks like yourself, and you see me fumbling around for like 10 minutes.
No, you didn't. No, you helped me troubleshoot this one, so that was great.
Yeah, I think a couple things. You know, my role, to tell you the truth, is it's being better defined, but I would say two things come to mind. One is vision casting, vision setting, you know, communicating vision. So there's a lot involved with that. I would say forming, refining, really targeting what our council believes is the direction for SOLA. That's one of my jobs. And then being able to really cast that and share that, hopefully in a clear and compelling way. So vision casting, vision propagating. And then second, I think it's network building, relationship building. Those would be, I think, at the forefront of what I understand my role to be. So the why and the who. The why does SOLA exist? Why do we do what we do? What's the big why behind this? What's the vision? And then second is who. Who are we going to do this with? Who can we get to do this with?
Let's answer those questions then. How would you say SOLA's mission statement, I guess in your own words, I can read it on the website, but I guess in your own words, and then also with who?
The vision has evolved. I'll just say it what it is right now. It's really to influence, shape the next generation with the gospel. And I believe we can do this better collaboratively. We can do it better together. We can do it better as a fellowship of churches in Jesus Christ who hold to the gospel. I think that's far more powerful and influential for the next generation than if we did it by ourselves. So three or four things kind of key that come together is the gospel. And I do not assume everyone understands what we mean when we say the gospel.
Sure. Good point. Yeah, good point. You're right.
Convinced about that. So the number one value or vision behind this is the gospel, the biblical gospel, the whole gospel, clearly and with compassion in the power of the Spirit, is the gospel really being taught and preached? Second, our target group is we do not want to grow older. We want to grow younger. We want to be future-based, not past-based. We're future-oriented, not past-oriented. And as you can tell, Aaron, that's how much I got to grow in terms of getting on Google Hangout.
You saw No. You're doing great. Yeah, this is good. This is really good.
So we started off by saying we want to be collegiate focused. That is a certain age that I find is a kairos moment. A kairos is a Greek word, is a very opportune, special. I just think it's an opportunity that you don't get often. And I think there's a lot of brain cells when you're in college. I think you have the most disposable time and energy in college. I think this is when you start just maturing and begin to really think and explore a lot of things intellectually, spiritually, socially, in every which way. So I just think college life is a kairos, opportune moment. I'm biased because that's when my spiritual life was most revived, was sure. When I was in college.
Okay.
So the gospel, the clarity of it. Second, collegiate target and base. And third is local church driven, local church collaborative. We want to learn from each other. We want to fellowship. We want to share resources. We want to show unity of the church, that we're one church of the world. And I just think we're going to do things better together than apart. So that's the vision. There's some evolutions here and there. We're tinkering with this and that a little bit. That's the why. That's the why. And then the who, it just began with a group of some collegiate directors, along with Pastor Steve Chang. And I was not there in that original meeting. I think a couple of meetings had occurred. But it involved our church, some of our ministries. And so, and then I think initially Steve Chang was really the one and others that came and asked if I'd be interested and join this. And back then it was not a movement or anything. It was not a network. It was not a movement. It was just, we were just trying to get our first SOLA conference off the ground.
Yeah.
That's all we were doing.
Well, that's no small feat, though. That's a very difficult thing to do.
Yeah. And so Living Hope hosted it, and I was asked to speak for it. And that's how I really kind of first got involved. So it was to speak for it. And then they happened to be my friends. Now, if you ask me today or even back then, why did you join SOLA? It's actually the same answer. I believed in the why. There was a good why. And initially, all we were thinking was there could be so much more done for LA college students. That if we pulled our resources together and prayed together and put something on together, we just think that would make a bigger impact of the gospel for collegiate students. So I was sold. I was sold on the why. Didn't think it would become a movement, just a conference. And the second was the who. Of course, the people who asked me, they're my friends and my brothers. I love them to this day.
Mm. Man, thank you for sharing that, Pastor Harold. I think that SOLA seems very blessed to have you. You're very clear and articulate on that. And I can tell that you're very convicted of it too. You know, it's not just mottos for you, but I do think you believe this.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
What are like the main flagship things that SOLA has to offer, just so we can have that available to anybody who's listening to this?
Sure. I mean, moving forward right now, right? After all of it's kind of tinkering and evolution. Right. Refinement.
Yeah.
Well, this is in no way meant to be repetitive, but I'm convicted by it most. I mean, Aaron, it's a dead giveaway. If you ask, you know, hell, what's your own philosophy of ministry? Like, what's your DNA?
Mm-hmm.
I happen to lead a church called Christ Central. It's never redundant for me. I cannot say enough that we've got to do a better job. If we were really preaching and demonstrating the true whole gospel, a lot more things would be happening. A lot more lives would be saved. A lot more lives would be challenged. I think we would be more winsome and more engaging, as well as we'd become more controversial for the right reasons. We'd be controversial because we're labeled and we stand for Christ. So I think the whole notion of when we say we want to be gospel-centered, I think that is a loaded word. I think it's a misunderstood word. I think it's become a very trendy buzzword, but I am convinced that it is a word that still most people no longer, no matter how long you've gone to church, and I've been to church my whole life, Aaron, I just do not think it has enough teeth, enough fire. I do not think it is really being impressed and digested as much as we wanted to. And I think that's a twofold problem. Number one, we have to better communicate it. And then number two, there's something in the supernatural sovereign realm of God. By his spirit, only he can do it. But our responsibility is to better communicate it. My spiel, the number one, two, three flagships of SOLA is this. First of all, what is the gospel? I think the gospel simply means it's by someone else's life, not by mine. Religion is about you. The gospel is about Jesus from start to finish. We're going through this series right now, but I think most people think the gospel is what I start off with in my Christian life. It's my ABC. When I get medium level on the ski slopes, when I become intermediate or advanced, the gospel is something you can just kind of forget and do away with. I could not disagree more. The gospel is not just step one, two, and three. It's your entire
rhythm. It's everything.
It's your entire vocabulary. Yeah. Correct.
Yeah.
So the same gospel that saves you at a Greg Laurie crusade, the same gospel that makes you cry and weep because you never understood it before that. And the first moment that you repent and confess all your sin and you cannot believe that God could love you and forgive you for all of that in Jesus. That same gospel that saves you the first day is the same gospel, though, that has to be taught and applied for the rest of your Christian life. It's the same gospel that changes you every day after that. All right. So I would say that is of premium importance, that at SOLA, we are preaching the gospel not only for non-believers to be saved, but we are always preaching the gospel for Christians to change and be sanctified. But it's the same basis. And I do not think Aaron, that I don't think a lot of churches or Christians have a grasp on that. I think it's just kind of a stepping stone, and kind of we step off of that.
Okay? Yeah, no, I totally hear what you're saying. People think that they can graduate from the gospel or move on to more deeper things, as if there's anything deeper or more substantial than the gospel of Jesus Christ.
That's right. That's right. And that's not to take away that when you preach the gospel, though, that we shouldn't be as detailed and practical and use imperatives and commands.
Articulate, like you said.
Yeah, we have to say all the things that come with it. So I would say that's one. That's just, again, a huge flagship just on the gospel. Number two, yeah, focusing on the future. So college students, what does that look like? What does that mean? How do we contextualize? And talking about the issues that are most relevant, talking about, you know, through and through, every human being is the same, but through and through, also, every human being is different, right, in every generation. So some of our themes that we have intentionally and prayerfully picked in some of the conferences past, I think they do reflect that we want to be sensitive to, and we want to contextualize toward college students. I think one year we really, really focused in on a lot of emotional and relational health, you know, light after darkness was one of those issues. One of the other years, we think that going to church, being really involved in the local church is key, and a lot of people are not doing that. So the entire church's theme was about church, right? Third, this I did not say up front. What does SOLA have to offer as a flagship? I think SOLA, I said, I think we want to skew and target younger. We want a lot more younger people in leadership involved. But third, I think SOLA uniquely offers this. I think we're Asian American led. I do not think of any other movement that would combine a robust biblical gospel that is led, and it comes through the voice and the lenses of Asian American leaders. This, I am super thrilled about. and I think the traction that we're gaining on digital media online, from what I understand, is that the Asian American issues, those are the ones that are kind of blown up.
Yeah, well, yes, even in the culture right now.
Yeah, even in the culture too. So it just shows you how much hunger and thirst there is for this. Because the way I grew up, Aaron, up until the 2000s, most, if not all of my Christian influence, leadership, books, training, heroes was given through non-Asian folks, majority white folks, and who I'm indebted to, and I love them and respect them, but I wish I had more Asian American leaders who could contextualize and apply the gospel in ways that a non-Asian cannot.
Yeah. And I echo that too. I agree with you on that from my perspective as well.
Yeah. And then a fourth flagship, I would say, I think this is well needed. I have a heavy heart that we really want to, connect with and care for and encourage and inspire and teach and befriend pastors and leaders in ministry. So that's why we have the leadership dialogue coming up. And so we got some of the leadership development, because being a leader in ministry is actually one of the most dangerous, treacherous things anyone can do.
I hear you on that.
And there is nobody in their right mind who started off in leadership who thought, you know, I love God, I'm so zealous about this, but then they thought, but you know, about 20, 25 years down the line, I'm going to flame out and scandalize myself.
Yeah, nobody has that dream.
No one has that agenda. No one has that mission. And yet, Aaron, it's happening so much.
Yeah, unfortunately, yes.
And I believe it's also because among leaders and pastors, we're isolated and competitive, and we're ashamed, and we're just trying to do things by ourselves. So I think something like SOLA Network can network pastors and leaders together as well. Yeah. I think it's imperative.
Wow. Yeah, that was great. And thank you, Pastor Harold. That was wonderful. Thank you for dropping a lot of that info and knowledge and wisdom. Actually, that's really good. It's good to hear from you.
Okay, good. I hope this is useful.
I think so. Yeah, I'm gonna take a look at this. We'll see if we can get it on the newsletter when it goes out. But thank you for being open to doing something a little bit out of the box, and even to meet with me, who, you know, we never met before. So I thank you for being open to that, Pastor.
I look forward to meeting you. It was a pleasure. This I can do anytime. You made it so easy.
Awesome.
If people can just talk with me and then they go back and write it up, I'm all for that. All right. Thank you, Aaron.
Thank you, Pastor Harold. Have a good evening.
You take care. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thanks, Pastor Harold, for being my guest on the show. And thank you, everyone, for listening. Please send me your feedback or questions for follow-up. You can even send me any questions specifically for Pastor Harold to follow up on, and I'll be sure to get to them in the next few episodes. In the show notes, you'll find the link to two videos that Pastor Harold recorded for the SOLA Network. They are, How Can Asian Americans Recognize and Help Dismantle Racism to Better Advance the Gospel? And, How Can God Use the Local Church to Bring Healing to the World? Pastor Harold is going to be speaking at the SOLA Leaders Dialogue event on Thursday, October 24th from 9:30 a.m. to 12 p.m. at Living Hope Community Church in Brea, California. Leaders in the church are subject to all sorts of challenges: internal feelings of inadequacy, external obstacles, and interpersonal conflict all threaten to derail leaders from fulfilling the ministry that has been entrusted to them. Rather than flourishing, many leaders in the church find themselves on the brink of exhaustion and defeat, ready to quit. So how can we thrive in the roles that God has entrusted to us? This year's Leaders Dialogue seeks to equip pastors and church leaders to thrive. Through a series of micro-talks and discussion groups, we are aiming to address various aspects of becoming healthy leaders. Tim St. John from Lighthouse Community Church will be speaking on cultivating emotional health. Michael Lee from All Nations Community Church will be speaking on cultivating organizational health. And Pastor Harold Kim from Christ Central Southern California will be speaking on cultivating relational health. We believe that thriving churches require thriving leaders. Join us as we seek to thrive together. Registration is free, but RSVP on Facebook and sign up on Eventbrite to secure a spot. I'll put the link in the show notes, but you can also check out the event over on the SOLA Network Facebook page. I curate a linked list column for SOLA every Friday. Be sure to check that out, and you can also subscribe to it via email. I'll put the link in the show notes. The SOLA Network publishes fresh content every weekday. Follow them on Facebook and Instagram at the SOLA Network. Speaking of Instagram, if you're into Bibles and books, check out my Dive In Dig Deep Instagram account. It is dedicated to the beauty of the Bible and the role of reading in the Christian life. Follow me at Dive In Dig Deep. In the show notes, you'll find links to the Sound Words podcast archive. And don't forget to subscribe to Sound Words on YouTube, Spotify, or your favorite podcast player. Just search for Sound Words. My website is musicgoon.com. The email address for this podcast is soundwords@musicgoon.com. And you can always tweet me at musicgoon. Thanks. See you soon.